I will come here.
Okay, so welcome to the Fedora ITN session. Can you hear me? I'm one of the programmers of the session also. So I actually, when I started this session, I imagine this more kind of informal discussion session. Unfortunately, we got this big room, which makes it very easy to do lots of discussions. But anyway, so I picked up some more slides to come try and fill out. But I still hope we will have some discussions. If you want to move closer, that's also fine. So this is kind of, maybe you notice this is kind of a track this afternoon. Now we have this session now, and afterwards, Cindy can talk about our trans project, which I mentioned, but we mentioned briefly later. But it's just a half an hour slot, so yeah. I don't want to take away too much of this. And afterwards, there's a globalization. Agenda, but I'm also, if anyone has any particular topics they'd like to discuss, you can. We don't really need to follow this slide deck. Actually, I think we want to have a big slide deck or a big long presentation. We're all hoping to have more discussion and so on. I'll ask again later on for what people want to talk about. There's lots of different ways we can take it, but these are just some of the things that we've been working on, but also we're pretty keen to get input on new ideas and feedback.
So basically, we are having this three-hour track for globalization. And if you are knowing, globalization is nothing but it's a part of ITN and LTNN. So it becomes an umbrella. GLevel is basically an umbrella that consists of internationalization. In short, we call it as an ITN. And localization, in short, we call it as an LTNN. So globalization is nothing but it's ITN and LTNN. So let me explain the internationalization. So what internationalization is that? Internationalization is nothing but adding a specific code to your existing software that will help you to make sure that software can be localized. So when that software can be localized, that means that it helps to make sure that your software will work uniformly across multiple regions. So what this means is that suppose you have some application that is showing an English UI strings, and you want to make sure that the same software will run in different languages, then there comes an internationalization part that will make sure that whatever the strings are available for that software, that will get extracted, that will be extracted into some form, say like a PO file, or any other form. And that will be available for the localization team for translation, and they will do the translation and submit it back to the upstream, and upstream will include it into the next release, and thus that software will get all such a different translations for different languages. So you just need to run that same software in your language, and thus that will make sure that it will work uniformly. So that is what I mean here. The software will work uniformly across multiple regions. So the next point, like I said, it includes adding ITNN support in your code. So basically, what adding ITNN support is nothing but there are multiple ITNN libraries. Say mostly used is a GetText library. So you can use this library to extract the UI messages from your software. So that is nothing but adding the ITNN support in your code, which allows UI strings to be translated. Now, internationalization also helps to set for that particular language, or you can say a locale, that language setting like a date, number, currency, sorting, and paper size. So these are the basic things that is needed while developing some locale for your language. Locale is basically a plain text file which defines everything that is needed for your language. Suppose your language is having certain format of date, certain format of number, certain format of currency. So all this information is included into a JDFC locale file, and that locale file will get used whenever you switch your language from one language to another language, so that selected language will get these all settings effective. So you will get all the environment set for your language. So that's why this JDFC locale is very important. Then comes a part like a display and input text. So internationalization also provides certain libraries, like input method IBUS is there. So it allows you to type in multiple languages. So input methods are there that will help you to type in your own language. So IBUS is the main basic input engine currently in Fedora. So there are multiple input methods that you can add to the IBUS engine, and you just need to select and start typing. And now we have, I think, very good number of input methods available for major languages almost. So if anybody sees that their language is not having an input method, they can, if needed, they can find some already available input method and they can submit it to Fedora, and that will get included into the Fedora, or they can write even they can submit it to the Fedora. So I think most of the languages are having input methods available, but if anyone wants to contribute, they can contribute it. So this is all about what internationalization basically is that. So also I would like to add further that internationalization contains three main parts, like input, display, and fonts. So these three are very important things. So these three makes sure that your system is running fine for your particular language. So I think we will see now what recently a Fedora ITNN has developed changes in Fedora. So let's start with the Fedora 24. In Fedora 24, internationalization team has proposed two changes. Those are nothing but LangPax installation with RPM big dependencies and GDFC local sub-packaging. Now, LangPax is a very important thing in Fedora because it allows you to set your Fedora system with all the needed translations. But remember one thing, that LangPax is available for very basic and certain number of packages only. It's not available for all the packages in Fedora. So some packages allows to separately create RPMs as a localized RPMs for that package. Like say if you have a LibreOffice, so there are multiple LibreOffice localized translation RPMs are available. The same thing is now for the GDFC also, but in GDFC we are not having a translation, but actually we are having a different locale files that is getting created in their own RPM languages. RPM files, sorry. So LACPACS is this thing. So if you are aware that in when we were using a Yum, there was a Yum LACPACS plugin. So Yum LACPACS plugin was taking care of all the things. But as we have moved to the DNF package manager, DNF package manager is providing certain restrictions to re-resolve the transaction. That's why the same Yum LACPACS plugin cannot be ported as it is to the DNF LACPACS plugin. But we tried it. But we tried our best to port it, and we tried to manage to port certain commands in DNF also. But we cannot add this functionality that suppose a Fedora is getting installed in certain language, then whenever that certain language the Fedora is installed, you should get all the LACPACS automatically installed in that operating system. But with the DNF it is not possible, because DNF is not allowing resolving the transaction. So what Yum plugin was doing is that while installing a Fedora operating system, it picks all the initial packages that are needed to install the Fedora on your system. And then if you are planning to add a certain different language than English, then it will check for those settings, and accordingly those settings it will add the LACPACS available for that language into the same Anaconda initial transaction. So what happened that it re-resolved the transaction, it add the needed LACPACS, and a whole transaction as a one transaction was getting installed there when there was a Yum. But the same thing is not possible with the DNF now, because it was not allowing to re-resolve the transaction. So only the initial set of packages required to install the Fedora was getting installed as of now. So so this discussion went on for few Fedora releases. DNF LACPACS plugin was unable to do that. So there was one concept introduced by RPM that is called as RPM tags. These tags are nothing but weak dependencies and rich dependencies. So what these weak dependencies are nothing but that you can add a certain line called as a supplements line into the spec file, and you need to build it. So what this approach is that you need to have special meta packages for the number of languages you want to make available the LACPACS. So we created almost 60 to 80 LACPACS packages in Fedora currently. So what you need to do with this approach is that you need to install like DNF install LACPACS hyphen fr. Suppose you want to install in French language all the LACPACS. So this will make sure that all the basic packages that are available on your system, like suppose for LibreOffice, it should be LibreOffice Core. Then if LibreOffice Core package is already installed on your system, it will pick that LibreOffice French LACPACS and it will install when you give a command like dnf install LACPACS-fr. So the same applies if there is any Huntsman packages available, like Huntsman-fr or Espen-fr, or glibc LACPACS, glibc local fr is also getting installed. So this actually is for the users that at least they have some way now that where they just say a command like dnf install LACPACS hyphen their language code, and all the needed LACPACS translations will get installed. Now with this thing we have solved this thing that re-resolve is not needed, but with the supplement stack it is going to pull all the needed RPM packages when you say dnf LACPACS hyphen that language code installed. Now this is the way to install manually. Now suppose if you want to make sure that if you select a French language and you try to install in French the Fedora, then whenever you installed it and started and you want to see the French translation for LibreOffice, it is not available there. Why? Because the thing is that LACPACS packages are not available on Workstation Live ISO. because they felt that if we try to add such a packages, then it will increase the size of the live ISO. So that's why they decided that the LangPax packages should not be added. I actually given a suggestion sometime back that there should be a ISO, proper ISO, DVD ISO should be available from the workstation team, but I'm not sure they talked to some conclusion, and I think they are still with the thing that there should not be any DVD produced for workstation team. There should be only a live ISO available for workstation product. So here comes the problem that as it is having a size limitation, it cannot include packages. So we are still trying this issue to be solved. I think we can, if needed, we can discuss it later on also. So this is what the change was there, LangPax installation with RPM build dependencies. But the thing is that if you try to install the Fedora using a net install ISO, it will work because net install ISO's Anaconda interface allows that thing because it picks the packages from everything requires. That's why it is there because it's a net install, so it can pull the language packages. But if you try to install from the live ISO, it is already having a very limited set of packages. So there is no option, but only to after installation you need to make sure that you apply the DNF install LangPax, say whichever code you have used for installation, you can use that thing. So that's it, the LangPax installation. So it's not yet complete, so we are just exploring what solution we can get to make sure that whenever a user installed a Fedora, he will get every LangPax available for that language. A glibc local sub-packaging. This was the change, I think that is mainly for where we needed to make sure that a very minimum ISO can be produced. Say for, I think, RPM OS 3 and Atomic Thing, they needed that. Whole local archive file is not needed because they think felt that all the local files are having a bit of size, oversize, so they don't need that much. So they decided that local archive file can be splitted into multiple local files, and they basically divided this glibc, single binary glibc file, the RPM package, into multiple RPM packages. So now we have multiple locale-based RPM files from glibc, and whenever you select a language, the particular glibc LangPax, that code FR supports, that RPM will get installed on your system. So that was this change, that we splitted this single local RPM file into multiple different locale files. That is what here is locale sub-packaging. Fedora 25 IDN changes. So in this release, we propose basically three different changes. That is IBUS emoji typing, Unicode 9, and IBUS typing booster multilingual support. Let's go through one by one. So IBUS emoji typing, this was first we introduced in Fedora 25. So this change basically proposed that you can type emoji characters using IBUS in your favorite editor. I think this change, basically IBUS package has been rebuilt with the Node.js emoji one's data file actually. So Node.js emoji one is not an actual dependency for IBUS, but only the IBUS user data file, which contains the definition of the emojis, and you just pick and build the IBUS, and it allows you to type emoji characters using this IBUS. That's what I think emoji picker is, right? It was basically that it allows you to type using Ctrl Shift E and then emoji characters. So that was the change that this was proposed. Even if you needed to type a particular emoji code point, if you are knowing, then the very basic method we have is that Ctrl Shift U and the Unicode code point. And if you do that, you can type your emoji character in your document file, or anywhere you want to type it. So this was the first that we introduced emoji typing in iOS. Then at that time, the next Unicode release, 9.0 version was released. So we just make sure that all the packages that are having a Unicode dependencies, Unicode standard following, we make sure that those packages are updated to follow the Unicode 9.0 standard. These are basically GMC files, and some font files are there. iOS Typing Booster multilingual support. If you are aware that iOS Typing Booster is like iTrans thing that allows you to type fast in your language. Now, iOS Typing Booster was there. Now, there was a need that iOS Typing Booster was not allowing you to type in support more than one language. Now, how to type this in more than one language? So, iOS Typing Booster. So there was some modification done to the iOS Typing Booster, whereby suppose if you are using certain language like Hindi language, so you just go select a Hindi language. In the setup, you just need to make sure that you need to enable the add direct input method. So add direct input method will allow you that whenever you select that Hindi input method, you will be able to type in Hindi as well as English in the same input method selected. So you will not need to make sure to change from Hindi to English, but with the with this setting, you are able to type in Hindi and English as well. So, if you want to know more about iOS Typing Booster, it's basically a suggestive text input, and this is the actually the home page where you can get the information about iOS Typing Booster.
that is there.
So another thing that's new in Thai English recently is that we can, well, this is separate to that Fedora feature, but we can also import the emoji in Thai English. There's quite a friendly UI for that, so you can type things like smile, whatever, and you can also turn this off because it's really slow, but so you can input a different emoji. These aren't appearing in color, I see. We'll come to the emoji more later, but also Unicode input is also possible, so you can type names of Unicode parts of Unicode characters. So it's quite an easy way to input emoji and Unicode also. The more you type, the smaller typing user gets, so
Who has submitted this change?
Pongo. And yeah, there's some changes to the opinion and interesting replies, but well, so in 2.1, basically, Pongo merged some of the traditional Chinese backend into the Lipinian now, so which should improve the speed and the quality for traditional Chinese literature. There's a lot of lip Julian, which is kind of been, I think it's not completely merged, but it's probably been merged in. According to, when I looked at the iOS lip Julian, which it still seems to be in the next anyway, so that's the other thing I do. Because there was quite a lot of common code between those two, so lip Julian is also doing similar things to lip. We've also been, well, these aren't actually formal code changes, but we've also been doing some work on Flatpak to enable iBus to work on Flatpaks. Most of that's been done during, I'm recently some patch bags, and last time I just merged to, I think I have this kind of. And another thing is sort of emoji color rendering, so yeah, we'll talk more about that.
But I think it's not much of an issue for the cloud or the server, but
contractors involved, because the gate office, I guess, is where the main content of for having that max installed. Maybe it's worth exploring that, and it would be a cheap discussion to have in the
station
part of the we should install the gate office. Maybe not all, maybe some sets of
stuff. Technically, it would be possible to have a different behavior for the federal workstation than for the
That's true. And also, I guess modularity might help with this too, because modularity allows like to have minimal profile or different profiles. So have a kind of a small profile, big profile. I'm not really sure about how big the comments are. I think it does have support for the comments. It's also, I was doing the usability testing in the area before. That's a really good point.
As we see, like, lots of things happening right now in Fedora. So, like, for each release, we used to have, say, 20 plus features or change proposals. So, in the next, so normally when any developer, like, say, developing any change proposal or feature, his first objective is to get that feature done rather than looking into the language perspective or anything. When that feature landed in the Fedora, say, in particular release, maybe in the next release we can take a look at that change proposal and see whether the admin aspects have been handled or not. So I think that can give us a good idea that what change proposal we should work. So like, I don't know, like Wayland was the one, the Flatpak is coming. So like, and there are many even minor changes are happening which actually affects admin side. So I think we should maybe, the way we do the itinerant cycle for each Fedora, so I think one of the thing which we should check that what are the proposals has been there in the last release. That we should do, and it can give us good idea.
So performance suggesting that a good thing to do going forward might be to look at releases and so changes in the last one, the latest release, and consider the item of those and maybe see the enhancements we can make or further changes. Locales to the future, wanted to. So, It has quite a wide capability with so we've been thinking about how we might want to do this. We kind of wanted to discuss here, or just to see if anyone had any suggestions or better ideas or so currently the three possibilities. If we do a live installation, then we don't get land packs. So let's say we work to, we don't get the land packs from our language, and that's where we come to be able to use it. So then how do we, well, one way is to install the metal land pack for your metal land pack package for your
land packs
meta package. Yeah. So you install land packs meta package for them, and then we'll put it in the land packs to the language for packages that you have installed. However, it's not very intuitive, so we'd like to have a more, or either automated or sort of graphical way of doing it. Maybe one more, there's one more thing. Fourth choice would be to do something in software. So the first option is kind of non, is a sort of desktop agnostic approach. That would be to do something in Conda post-installation. So this should work even for live, if you have live recognition, then you put in the conditional RPM transaction to, because we don't really need it for live though, since network installs will install the automatically. In a way, it's, this way is it doesn't matter whether you're installing a GNOME or some other desktop or server or whatever, we will cross all of those. Or you could do it on GNOME, and in GNOME setup, you could have some extra screen or checkbox, or just some people suggest it should just be done behind the scenes even. The only problem I see with that is that it's not, maybe it might depend on the distribution you're on, or I'm not sure how Debian or Ubuntu would want to do this. Also, the UI is kind of not trivial intensive. It takes an infinite amount of time to install land packs, so I might have to fork off some other something to do that in the background or something. But again, there's also kind of risks, like say someone then changes language and then they you start restart your session and maybe you're still installing the package and then the installation fails or something. It's a bit fragile maybe, but then the third approach, which could also complement the second one, but it would be to do something in control center to have some way to install land packs. This would allow installing multiple land packs and also doing it post later on after your initial login. So, none of the social things might be perfect. Then the fourth solution might be to do something in the GNOME software.
I think GNOME Control Center might be good because if I want to add an input method, I normally go to GNOME Control Center. So in this, on the same line, if I want to add in a new language, so my ideal way, where should I go? It should be GNOME Control Center.
I have a different opinion. I think we should avoid implementing it in GNOME Initial Setup and the GNOME Control Center because GNOME is not the only desktop for Fedora. There are other desktops. And also GNOME is not only in Fedora, it's also in other distributions. So I would like, I think that initial setup is a good place if we are going to stick with Fedora only.
Okay.
And even better it would be to support it in PackageKit, in my opinion. Because PackageKit is a cross-distribution solution.
Do you mean the software center?
Yes, software center will be good as long as we remember that GNOME software is just one of the front ends which are possible to build on top of PackageKit. So if we choose PackageKit, we are open for GNOME, for KDE, for other desktops, and as well for other distributions.
I guess the first approach would be to create a new tool to kind of take care of this. We have, in the past we have things like system complete language. Install language. Did there some situation?
Yeah.
So install groups.
Some public languages also can help you to install the lang packs. So we have made it, but it's not that efficient
actually. No.
Because people need to install it manually because of the extra package. So there should be some way that should come from the original installation, not from some extra package. So I think this is the thing for making sure that whenever a Fedora operating system is getting installed, people should get the lang pack installed at the same time. So they should not be needed to go do something, add some extra package and then add these lang packs packages. So I think that's why we are trying to find some solution here on the lang packs. Basically, that's the thing.
Yeah, and I think different approaches have different merits. I mean, the first two have the merit that they will be kind of forces of bad work. The other approach is you need to go and do something yourself to install them. But the idea was, I think, well, kind of attractive that it happens because, well, typically the users would probably have trouble with this, they're probably the ones who are going to have trouble finding these solutions. Having this solution kind of go forward.
Don't you already, I mean, you select your language during the initial setup, and
right.
Can it just happen?
Right.
Does it need an extra step on that?
No, probably not.
In the initial setup, even if you choose your language, the lang packs itself are not available in the live CD.
Sure, but if you do...
So your total operating system will get installed with the initial package set.
Yeah.
But there is no provision for installing the extra lang packs packages. So you need to do that manually after installing the Fedora operating system.
Right.
Someone suggested that it could be done with that.
Okay.
Or that it could, that piece right there could send some signal off saying, I've set the language. Because you can imagine wanting to do it from multiple places. Your initial setup, you set the language. But if you then go in later in the control center and change your language at a later time, you might want that to also fire off this process of like, go give me my lang patch for the language I just selected.
Yes, it'd be done like a debus or a deconference.
So I think any one of these things could fire off that signal. The question is what listens to the signal.
We are trying to find a solution actually. So we have found these three ways. I mean the initial setup, initial setup and GNOME control center. But when you say GNOME, that means it's specific to the GNOME environment.
And I like the proposal here of making that something that PackageKit handles. And
yeah.
Then it's something that control center or GNOME initial setup, any of these things, they could tell, any one of them could tell PackageKit. PackageKit does the work. So the work is agnostic, but we know it can still look into it.
I think we need to explore the PackageKit solution as well. Yeah, we will check on that. PackageKit. Thanks.
to me, that doesn't matter. So, that's easy, you know, but, I'm just reviewing, so we have this KKC for Japanese and Lippini for simplified Chinese. And Libyuring for Russian Chinese. These are all supposedly intelligent, but they use some trigrams to make predictions about what you're trying to say. I can say the Japanese we're still quite far behind the quality of many poetry I mean for Japanese, so but I don't know. I guess most things is it's not very good, maybe they're all alternative to KKC's Google's FATPAC now, we're making things that we made complete versions in the future. There's not a lot of activity, at least from that point of view. The number of activity that I am, there's not so much innovation happening now, so I feel like, changes running to Cairo recently to fix the engines. we tell them we're going to see Bella running in my room. Now there's a few different ways to input, or will be at least, I'm not sure whether it's an intelligent system. GTK, Matthias Larsen recently implemented emoji input also in GTK 3. We have the iOS. So that should work for non-iOS. iOS has support for emoji input, also typing visualizations. There's a few different ways now to. Yes, we also some work, more work is happening on upstream with VLC. Mike Fabian also became upstream GLC maintainers working on locales. So I think for a long time the locales have been neglected. There's not so much attention, so we kind of started working on updating the Unicode, updating GLC today's Unicode, fixing the problems, so it's fixing some of the Python scripts to update the especially the latest Unicode. But a lot of bugs and things that we're improving. Another thing that we want to work on is trying to bug sync CLDR Unicode data to GFC. It's quite a lot of work. So it's more a long-term project.
Date and time, paper size, etc. Such things. Rather no messages. Unless yes, no, this is in CLDR, nothing more. That's all what is in TMC.
So what's happening? I already mentioned a little bit about Flatpak. We won't go into too much detail, but yeah, so we're hoping now to, I think, the next, and also the, I could maybe add that the I module, GTK I module has been added, I think, to the runtime, I guess. I don't know which one is next. I don't exactly which version you're landing, but if the next version is on or something like that, or the next version will be through desktop. So that should enable us to work on the level of Flatpak applications. And also, there's some problem with the cache of the phone config in Flatpak, which makes the phone config not working very well, so upstream content phase working on doing some path mounting to try and tweak the I think that I have the solution hasn't been finalized, but hoping to do something to tweak the phone cache path so that they work on the phone cache paths are different from the front pack now on the opposing systems.
Thanks for giving me opportunity. So
hi all.
So I think this is the first session which we got so much time and we are discussing it so deeply. From font side, fonts is inseparable part of the whatever the computing device we are using. Whatever you see, there is some fonts in the background. And when we say Fedora, I will say that we are doing very good from the font perspective in Fedora. But thing which we are more concerned in Fedora is like default fonts. And when I say the default fonts, normally the IDN is not that much concerned with the English font because GNOME team itself takes care of the Latin font, basically the English font for the default. But the default font for the language is that which we take care. Now we have like default fonts for the Indian locales, we have for the Japanese locales, for Sri Lanka. So there are many. And what issue right now is that it's a long time there has been many fonts came to the, I will say, free and open source world, and we have not revised the list of default fonts in the Fedora. That thing I always worry, but same time languages are very sensitive, the people are very sensitive with their languages. So if we want to change anything for any particular languages, say if I want to change anything for the French languages, so I need to take some review from the community before I do any changes. So same way, I think we should now revise our default font list sometime and see if we can select the, say, the latest fonts which are the more updated with the Unicode changes which have been happened. The second point is the Noto font. So again, this is on the same line. So Noto, this font has a wider coverage. So Noto is like Noto. The objective of the font is that to provide font for the all Unicode the encodings, all the languages which are available in the Unicode, and it has a wider coverage. So I think if I say in the free and open source world, this is the only font which is available which has wider coverage. So if you have a Noto installed in your machine, it means you don't need to that much worry about for the fonts. You will get most of the things ready. You will not get a square box. Then the Liberation font. Liberation font is like, though one of the older font, but it is a widely used font, and I often see lots of some issues reported against it. Those issues used to be very complex. It's like one pixel, it is rendering one pixel more or it is rendering one pixel less. It's more from the hinting side, and I always find it very difficult to debug those kind of issues. Couple of years back, I think 1.5 years back, the fork cross OS font and for the Liberation 2. So right now we have two versions of Liberation font. There is the Liberation 1, which is the classic Liberation. It has a bytecode hinting information, and those are rendering much better. And then there's Liberation 2, which is mostly automated hinting information are there for Liberation 2. And there is a dilemma. Few people say they want to use Liberation 2 because it's very latest. It provides you the good outline rendering. And few people say they like bytecode hinting. And we did that change, I think, around Fedora 22 something, if I remember it correctly. But there was lots of user said it has a regression, and we switched back to Liberation 1 then. But Liberation 2 is in use right now. So LibreOffice people use Liberation 2. And same time, the workstation guys recently reported issue, bug. They say that they want to package Liberation 2 with the workstation. That is what they say. Then fonts coverage. Fonts coverage and fonts coverage. font storage, as I said, what we drive in default installation. So if you are expecting that with the Fedora default installation, you will get all the fonts like for the all Unicode, so that is not realistic because we have a limited space. So what approach we are following right now is like we are installing the fonts for BMP, that is the basic multilingual plane of Unicode. So basic multilingual plane of Unicode provides the script for which are active right now. So what we are trying to do is we are at least providing a one font for each script. So whenever like you see, go to any web page or anything and you get those points, the code points, you will not get a square box. But same time, there was one approach which is available ideally, but it's not working. That if the rendering engine wants any particular code and that font is not available, normally they query the database, package database, and see if any other font is providing that font or not. So that is also a good approach. I think we need more testing on that side. So please just, I think if you add that, I will just make sure that. And fonts quality, so I think we are not. We did a font audit some couple of years back maybe, and it reported many bugs. But I think it mentioned so many warnings. So if we can just make that report more concise and see that what things we need to improve, it will make it more sense. So I think for fonts quality we need to be more realistic. The report which I saw, it had so many things, like 4 to 5 pages report for one font. And so normally if there are so many things, so we ignored it. So that's it from font side. But if anyone has any query, issue, or suggestion from the font improvement side, I think we can discuss it because we have some time.
Transcats. I'm not going to say anything about this, but it's an application for tracking and translations that somebody's working on. We'll be talking about that in the following sessions. Hopefully, we'll be ready for 2027. Okay, another big topic that came across has been modularity. We're starting to think now about what that means for ITN. Still not completely sure what, modularity is still kind of in flux, but things like input methods or chaos, fonts, and so on. It may make sense for some contexts to modularize some of this. So, yeah, band packs, I guess, will also come under this, actually. So, we'll be talking about it. So, I think that's a really interesting topic. a few other topics, I'll just mention them quickly because we're running out of time. Well, it's somewhat related to modularity, but the atomic, floor atomic and also atomic workstation. Actually, I was playing with Fedora Atomic yesterday, but they seem to actually install all the locales for the Atomic, it's in Fedora 26 Atomic, so which kind of surprised me. Well, yesterday in the Atomic workstation session, Patrick and Ron were saying that Atomic workstation only has English and Wireframe handling. So, yeah, how we want to handle locales for things like cloud images and so on. So, yeah, I'm super this is a very small thing that's always bothering me. It's quite hard to find the US layout in Conda if you don't have the US layout. So, I think the UI is not really ideal, but not to improve them.
So this slide I want to bring is that in Fedora automated testing right now, from admin part of the site, there are many few things are covered. I was checking with the Adam yesterday, and we used to have a test day as well, but of course. Even if we consider test day, so we have a limitation on the people who participate and the test cases which are there. What we are planning from onwards that we want to put more efforts on the automation. So as I said, the fonts, so I want to have a font, individual font level automation testing, like the rendering is not proper or something. For input level, so I want to like just click it, the input method in some say text window and check whether all things are working or fine, local testing. So that is what we are planning in next coming year. There are many things to test actually, if you see. So mostly we are, from the automation perspective, we are going to do like model level testing. For font, we will have testing. For rendering, for harvest, we have some test cases. Icon tool level, we have some test cases. So once we have a model level testing, I think with CI framework, all things will, like, we can reduce the time and also improve the accuracy.
So with that, I think we'll start wrapping up. There's a couple of topics I have in mind, but I think we're out of time. So one is about, ITIN versus globalization of Fedora. Maybe we could talk about it in the globalization session perhaps after. To get more contributors involved in the other options. There's a few crazy ideas here, like dynamic local switching, separation of translations. This one, last one, also crazy, but how to deal with the fallback of locales or fonts and so on. So, currently, I only